problem really hasn't got to do with measurement. It has simply to do with the fact that if you interpret the formalism of quantum mechanics, as most people, excluding the Bohmians, we can talk about that separately, but if you're not a Bohmian, then the kind of interpretation you give to the quantum formalism at the microscopic level essentially says that in, for example, a standard two-slit experiment, whatever you may say positively, the one thing you're not allowed to say is that each individual electron went through one slit or the other. Okay. As I say, you know, you could say that it went through both, it went through neither, the whole question is undefined, but the one thing that you really aren't allowed to say is that each one, one thing or the other. And yet, of course, we know that at the macroscopic level, it seems that things happen or don't happen. In fact, it seems we somehow don't even have the mental framework to describe things in any other way. So the question is, how do you effect, achieve the result that a definite outcome is affected at the macroscopic level? And that really doesn't have much to do with whether what you were doing was a sort of technical measurement or not. So let's just try to very briefly look at this. I suspect most of you are familiar with this, the content of at least this first view graph. Quantum mechanics is a linear theory, and therefore, if an initial state psi 1 evolves into psi prime 1, and an initial state psi 2 evolves into psi prime 2, then a linear combination of those two states with arbitrary complex coefficients evolves into the same linear combination with the same complex coefficients. And similarly for the density matrices. So now let's consider an interaction between a microsystem S with some complete set of orthonormal states, phi sub I, and some macrosystem M. It may or may not have been deliberately set up as a measuring apparatus, but it does have the property that when the measuring apparatus starts in state psi 0 and the system starts in one of the appropriate eigenstates, phi sub I, then as a result of the interaction between the system and the measuring apparatus and the consequent evolution, the final state is one in which the system may be in some fairly arbitrary state. We're not going to be terribly interested in that. But the macro system is in some macro state psi sub I. And the crucial point now is that the final states of the apparatus or the macro system corresponding to different, orthogonally different input states of the system are themselves orthogonal. Moreover, they're not merely orthogonal, they're macroscopically distinct. Okay? So, of course, the standard example is good old Schrödinger's cat, where I think most people would agree that not only are the states of being alive and being dead mutually orthogonal, they're also very macroscopically distinct. And now suppose that the initial state of the system is some linear combination of the appropriate eigenstates. Then, inevitably, by the linearity principle, the final state of the universe is an entangled state of the system and the apparatus, or the macro system. In other words, it's a quantum superposition of states of the universe in which the state of the macro system is macroscopically distinct. Again, a standard example, Schrödinger's cat. Yet, as far as we are conscious at least, only one macro state is realized or absorbed. Now, there's a fairly trivial technical problem. Of course, in real life, the macro system is very unlikely to start in a particular pure state. We're going to have to describe it by a mixture of states. However, it's straightforward to generalize the argument to that. All you have to assume in that case is that the macro states, the final macro states in the thermodynamic sense of the apparatus are distinct. And one way of doing that is to insist that the first of all, the traces in the different final states, satisfy that orthogonality relation there. And secondly, that in some agreed sense, the different rho sub I, the different final thermodynamic states of the apparatus, correspond to macroscopically distinct states. Just one minor point about this argument. I put in a final state, phi prime sub I, for the system, but that really is fairly irrelevant. It might not even exist. For example, in the case of absorption of a photon, the final state of the electromagnetic field is the vacuum, irrespective of the polarization of the photon in question. So in that particular case, you would lose the property of entanglement of the system with the apparatus, but that's irrelevant. All you're interested in really is the final state of the universe containing the apparatus. Okay, I trust everyone's pretty familiar with that argument. Okay, let's turn to some of the alleged solutions of the realization problem in the literature. I think to classify these solutions is helpful to ask a couple of questions. First of all, let's ask the question, well, do we expect that the formalism of quantum mechanics, as was supplemented by the standard measurement axiom, is going to correctly predict the experimental data up to, for the indefinite future, at all levels, up to and including our own direct consciousness? Okay. Most people, I think most practitioners today of quantum mechanics would probably, I think, tend to give the answer yes to that question. Let's suppose the answer is yes, for the sake of argument, and we'll go on to the other case later. Then let's ask a second question. Let's ask, do you believe that the formalism of quantum mechanics actually corresponds to anything, in some sense, out there at the microscopic level, which I've denoted by mu, and or at the macroscopic level, m? Okay, so what I'm asking there is quantum mechanics something more than simply a calculation recipe? It is simply more than a set of symbols on a piece of paper which you write down in the hope of predicting correct experimental outcomes and so forth. Okay, and I think you can classify the most at least of the alleged solutions of the quantum measurement problem according to how they answer those questions, first at the microscopic level and then at the macroscopic level. So on one end you have the Everett Wheeler or many worlds interpretation. I'll just say a little about that in a moment, since we could go questions specifically about that. You have the mentalistic interpretation by which, in some sense, nothing actually happens until a human consciousness is involved. You have this rather interesting, do people know about Shulman's Calvinistic interpretation? It's a rather amusing one. It basically starts from the observation, which is certainly true within the usual formalism of quantum mechanics, that given any unique final macroscopic state of the universe, I can always find an initial state from which it could have evolved. I simply run Schrödinger's equation backwards, the time-dependent Schrödinger's equation backwards, basically, and I can always find some initial state of the universe which would have led to that final state. Now, of course, that initial state of the universe is going to be horribly entangled and incredibly messy, but crudely speaking, Shulman's interpretation is that, well, maybe for some peculiar reason, experimentalists who think that they are adjusting their parameters freely and so forth are constrained always to start in these very exotic initial states. So if that's really the case, then it sort of removes the idea the experimenter, by his or her free will, can just turn the knobs and adjust whatever initial state they want. So that's why I call it the Calvinistic interpretation. Anyway, all of that, but it does share with Everett Wheeler and the mentalistic interpretation the idea that at least at all levels below our own direct consciousness, the quantum formalism really is saying something about the real state of the world. At the other end of the scale, you have the say, the Copenhagen, the original Copenhagen interpretation, what I call the quantum information theoretic interpretation, which is really just a sort of updated version of the original Copenhagen interpretation. And those, crudely speaking, those interpretations say, well, look, you just don't want to take all this too seriously. All that the formalism of quantum mechanics ever was and was ever intended to be is a recipe. It's quite literally nothing more than a recipe. You write down the symbols on a piece of paper, you play around with them, you end up with some prediction of the relative probabilities, let's say, of directly observed macroscopic outcomes. In other words, you all in the Schrödinger's cat situation, just don't take the symbols seriously. All that you do is to run through it, apply at the end of the day, apply the standard quantum measurement axiom. That should give you the probability that when I take the lid off this particular box, I see that this particular cat to be, let's say, dead. Okay? No more than that. So, in some sense, you being cynical, you could say that within this interpretation, the quantum formalism has no more meaning or reality than the sort of formalisms which the ancient Chaldeans are said to have used to calculate eclipses. They got it brilliantly right for many years doing that, but looking back, we now know that it's just, in some sense, a load of gibberish that they were using. Maybe that's the case with quantum mechanics, though it certainly seems to have been remarkably successful in this respect. Just skipping the orthodox for a moment, the Neo-Bohmian interpretation most certainly says, yes, at the microscopic level, the symbols which occur in the formulas of quantum mechanics do correspond to something in the real world. There is a wave function which corresponds to a real pilot wave. There's also something which is not in the standard formalism. There's a particle which has a definite position and so forth. But yes, certainly the wave function, the state vector, does correspond to something in the real world. Now, what about at the macroscopic level? Well, as I said yesterday, I don't know, because I have not yet succeeded in getting out of any of the leading neo-Bohmians a straight answer on this question, whether what they believe the status of the state vector to be at the macroscopic level. So let's leave that unanswered. The orthodox or decoherence interpretation, which I'll come to in a moment in more detail, effectively tries to have its cake and eat it, to say, yes, at the micro level, the formalism of quantum mechanics does correspond, crudely speaking, to something out there in the real world. By the time you get up to the macroscopic level, the level of cats and counters, no, it has no such significance. Okay, so let's just say a word, since I was asked to explain a little more in more detail the Everett Wheeler, or many worlds, or relative state interpretation. As I said already, in its original form, in Everett's thesis, and in the original Everett Wheeler RMP, essentially a statement about various formal theorems in quantum mechanics with a minimum of metaphysical overlay, at least as I read the paper. Later, De Witt and Graham wrote a second, I think, RMP, where they put a very strong metaphysical overlay on the formalism. According to this formalism, every time that you have some kind of measurement situation, say, it doesn't have to be measurement, but let's take that for definiteness, you have a measurement situation, the standard interpretation of the formalism would say, well, you get a definite outcome, and this is the probability that you get outcome A rather than outcome B. So each particular Schrödinger's cat is seen to be either alive or dead. And that situation, the De Witt-Graham interpretation of the formalism would say, not at all. The universe still is in a quantum superposition of states in which the cat is dead and one in which she's alive. That's why you still have the lid on the box. Okay. So at that point, no definite outcome has been realized. The universe has, as it were, split into two non-communicating branches, in one of which the cat is dead and the other of which she's alive. Okay, then you say, well, okay, but I've just taken the lid off this particular box and this particular cat seems to me to be alive and well. What is the ontological status of the part of the state vector which says that she's dead? And at that point, the advocates of the DeWitt Graham version tell you, well, what you have to realize is that there is a parallel universe which is equally real to the one you think you observe, in which this particular cat is alive and, is dead. And moreover, not only do you see her to be dead, but your colleagues will agree that she is dead, etc., etc. And then, of course, they use the formal theorems, which were proved originally in Everett's thesis, to argue that in some sense there can be no contact or interference between these different parallel universes. But they are, quote, equally real, unquote, to the one you think you observe. At this point, I'm afraid my original training as a philosopher takes over. I simply cannot take this seriously. The reason I can't take it seriously is that, you know, these words, equally real, they sound like English. What are they actually supposed to mean? You know, what meaning can one possibly attach to the statement that, you know, there is going to be never any possibility whatever, even the remotest possibility of ever observing or making contact with these so-called parallel universes, and yet they are, quote, equally real? It seems to me totally meaningless. Quite frankly, let me deliver myself of a strong opinion at this point. Since there's no one in this room, hopefully, who seriously believes all this stuff, I really think, I mean, a lot of people do take it very seriously. I mean, there are some quite well-known figures in the foundations of quantum mechanics and quantum information who've written whole papers which are based on this idea. I think 200 years from now, when historians of science look back on this particular period in the history of 21st century physics, they're going to be amazed that so many otherwise intelligent people could take this nonsense seriously. So anyway, that's my personal opinion. Okay, the mentalistic interpretation in some sense needs a slightly separate discussion, because the mentalistic interpretation does say, yes, indeed, at the end of the day, there is a particular outcome, but it is only realized when the first conscious observation, the first observation by human consciousness is made, or more generally, the first observation by some kind of, quote, sentient being, unquote. I think John Bell's comment on that one is quite good in the context of quantum cosmology. It says, according to this point of view, when exactly did the galaxies take the configuration that we now observe them to have? Was it when the first amoeba crawled out of the primeval slime and started squinting at them? Or did it take a more sophisticated observer armed with a PhD to actually pin them down? So again, that has some difficulties. So turning to the other end, as it were, the quantum information theoretic point of view, this is, I think, it's a well-defined interpretation of the formalism of quantum mechanics. As I say, it really, in some sense, is an updated version of the Copenhagen interpretation. There are various, what I would call, sub-versions of this quantum information theoretic point of view. For example, the so-called consistent histories interpretation, which basically is making the point that, okay, in reality we believe that the formalism of quantum mechanics is nothing more than simply a recipe written down on a piece of paper. Nevertheless, in many circumstances, it's possible to interpret it in more, if you like, quasi-objective terms. That is, once I've got a particular outcome to my experiment, then I can, as it were, retrace the history and say, well, at least to a certain point back in time, it's consistent to assume that the events which led to this particular outcome were realized, etc., etc. And to an extent that you can carry out that program, but I don't really see what it adds to the original point of view. So there's nothing inconsistent, as it were, about this, what I call this quantum information theoretic point of view, the idea that the whole formalism is nothing more than a recipe. But I think you still have some unpleasant questions. And I suppose the most unpleasant question is, okay, at what point, we do agree in this interpretation that definite outcomes are realized, right? There's one and only one way that the world is right now, not a whole system of set of parallel worlds. But at what point was that particular world realized, as it were? And this is, I guess, some part of the point of the consistent histories interpretation. It says, well, you can take that back quite a long way in time if you want to, and you won't get any contradictions. Nevertheless, it's still an unpleasant feature, I think. I mean, if you really take that interpretation seriously, then the question, now I have this box inside which there is a cat. This cat is part of an ensemble of cats which are being prepared according to the same recipe and so forth. While I still have the lid on the box, what is the state of that particular cat? And I think if you really take this quantum information theoretic point of view seriously, you have to say, well, you know, the question is meaningless. All I can tell you is that if you take the lid off the box, you maybe have a 50% probability of seeing her alive. Finally, let me come to the orthodox or decoherence interpretation. That interpretation, I call it orthodox because I think it is the point of view to which many working physicists have come more or less naturally when they start to wonder about the interpretation of quantum mechanics. I mean, they've been using this stuff for many years, but someday some rather irritating student comes along and badges them about how you interpret the formalism. They have to start thinking about it. And I think this is the sort of thing with which many people independently have come up spontaneously, as a result of which, of course, there are probably hundreds of papers in the literature rediscovering this point of view as if it was new. Let's consider, what we're going to use is what I call the fundamental theorem of decoherence, which I'm sure you're all familiar, but let me just go very briefly through it. Let's consider two systems, one and two, with a complete set of eigenfunctions, phi I and chi I separately, and some operator which is of the form of omega 1 cross the unit operator in 2. In other words, omega 1 is in general non-trivial. You're going to make non-trivial measurements on your system 1, but you're not going to be able to correlate those with measurements on system 2. Then, if 1 and 2 are decoupled, and 1 is in a non-trivial superposition, then in general, the expectation value of omega in the representation of interest is going to have off-diagonal terms. In other words, I'm going to have a formula like this one here. Now suppose that 1 and 2, by some kind of interaction, have become maximally entangled. That is, the wave function of the universe is now this, where the chi i's, the wave functions of system 2, are mutually orthogonal. Then the expectation value of omega is given by this formula here, and because these two states, chi I and chi j, are mutually orthogonal, that means that this gives you a delta ij, and so at the end of the day, you've washed out the diagonal terms in the expectation value of system 1. And so is everyone clear, happy about that result? I mean, I assume it's very familiar to all of you. So that's what I call the fundamental theorem of decoherence. And now, the orthodox argument goes something like this. Step one, which is usually stated explicitly, is that the rate of entanglement with the rest of the universe, and therefore the rate of decoherence, increases strongly with the size or complexity of the system, and therefore, generally speaking, by the level the time you get to the level of cats and counters, etc., it will be complete. Okay, I'm prepared to go along with that, with the caveat that we are going to see later, in this probably the next lecture, some examples where that doesn't happen. But for most standard situations, let's agree that it happens. Step two, which is essentially just a restatement of this formal theorem here, is that once the decoherence is complete, then all experimental predictions are identical to those for a classical mixture, that is, a description in which the system definitely is in one or other of the possible states with some probability C sub I squared. You can see that, I think, directly from that formula there. Again, agreed. Step three is not usually stated explicitly in the many articles, many papers which have appeared along these lines. It's usually swept under the rug and just assumed. Therefore, it's claimed, by the level of cats and counters, etc., you can legitimately say that the system actually is in one of your states I with probability C I squared. Okay. So let me just make a few comments on that argument. Some general comments about the, objections to it. And what you've implicitly assumed in this argument, among other things, is that once we've got our system entangled with some environment, you're not going to be able to make correlated systems, correlated measurements on the system and the environment. That is, measurements in which form omega 1 cross omega 2, where omega 2 as well as omega 1 is non-trivial. Is that a reasonable assumption? Well, I think that depends a lot on where you are and what you're talking about. In 1930, it would have been presumably impossible to make correlated measurements, or at least very difficult, to make correlated measurements on pairs of photons emitted in a cascade process. Nowadays, it's totally routine. In 1999, there were still a lot of people who claimed that you were, because, crudely speaking, because squids were many particle systems and therefore at least implicitly involved this kind of situation, any experiments to see macroscopic quantum superposition in squids were totally ridiculous. Now there are dozens of them in the literature. You shouldn't let, this is John Bell's point, you shouldn't let your interpretation of the quantum formalism depend on the current state of your technology. There's a second issue, which is somewhat related to the first. And again, this is something which I think is not often emphasized, and certainly, in my opinion, not emphasized enough in the literature. Suppose we find that we have a reduced density matrix, rho 1, for our system, which is nearly diagonal, perhaps even close to the unit matrix. Does that preclude the observation of spectacular interference effects in the future? The answer is no, it doesn't. We have the phenomenon which in the literature has sometimes been called false decoherence. And let me give you first a rather informal and then a slightly more formal example of false decoherence. The first example is the neutron interferometer. We normally think of a standard neutron interferometer experiment in roughly the following terms. The neutron is essentially an isolated system. It proceeds from a source to some kind of screen. Well, I say a screen in which there are two slits. That's, of course, not quite literally true. You have two ears of silicon crystal or something like that, but effectively it's the same. It proceeds to a screen with two slits. Passes through those slits, is deflected, the beams recombine, and you get the standard interference phenomenon. And indeed, this is well verified experimentally. However, let's now think about something which people don't usually worry about, namely that the neutron has a spin. Associated with that spin is a magnetic moment, and the magnetic moment can interact with the blackbody radiation field. And now, exactly how strong the effect of that is going to be will depend on your detailed assumptions about how the interaction is cut off at short wavelengths or high energies or whatever, and I'm giving you a problem on that this week. But certainly you would expect that the off-diagonal elements would be quite strongly suppressed by this interaction, right? So if I were to ask the question, at the time when the neutron passes the screen with the two slits, if I take as my basis, crudely, a basis in which the states correspond to slit 1 and slit 2, what are the off-diagonal elements? Well, if the radiation field has indeed suppressed the off-diagonal elements, then they'll be essentially zero, or at least small. I mean, not necessarily zero. They might even be 80%, 90%, but they're still not 100%. Right? Nevertheless, when we recombine our beams, we get essentially 100% interference. So what's gone wrong? Well, I think it's fairly clear intuitively what's gone wrong. The neutron spin is, as it were, polarizing the black body radiation field, but it's doing it in an adiabatic way. So as the two parts of the neutron wave function move apart, the parts of the black body radiation field wave function which are associated with it adiabatically change. So now you have neutron here, state 1 of EM field, neutron here, state 2. And state 1 and state 2 might be quite different. You have to calculate how different they are. But by the time the beams reconverge, the states of the electromagnetic field also pull back into their original form. So you get all the standard interference phenomena. A slightly more technical example, which illustrates the same point. Suppose I have a spin boson problem, standard spin boson problem, so a system tunneling between two states, let's say between two potential wells, with some amplitude delta, and it's coupled to a bath of simple harmonic oscillators with a coupling which, as it were, tries to observe whether it's in well 1 or well 2. However, what's essential here is that the floor of the frequency spectrum of the oscillators is much larger than the tunneling frequency. Now, under those conditions, it's, I think, extremely plausible to try to apply a lowest order Born-Oppenheimer approximation. That is to say, okay, I believe that I could look at the problem the following way, as it were. I have a certain probability amplitude for the system to be, let's say, on the right, plus state. If it's on the right, then the environment would have been dragged into instantaneous equilibrium with that. So the environment would be polarized in one way. Then there's another amplitude for the system to be on the left. In that case, the radiation field would be polarized in a different way. This is, crudely speaking, what in chemistry is called the usual solvation model. And it may well happen, and if you tune the parameters right, you make it happen, that the overlap of the two environmental states is very, very tiny. So the order of the exponential of the Frank-Condon factor for this problem, you can certainly make that very small compared to 1. So suppose we take that as a lowest order description. We can always try to calculate the, or try to bound the corrections to that description. Let's take that for the moment. It turns out, if you take that description, there will be a time when the magnitude of the two coefficients, A and B, is equal. At that point, the reduced density matrix of your spin, your two-level system, has halves along the diagonal, and then the off-diagonal elements are suppressed by this incredibly tiny factor, e to the minus f. So that's very, very, looks as if it's very, very near to being totally decohered. So it's very tempting at this point to draw the conclusion that, yes, you have indeed effected full decoherence, and thereafter you're never going to be able to see any interesting effects of interference of these two states. Not true, not at all true. If you actually evolve that Born-Oppenheimer function carefully later on, you'll find that after roughly twice the time, the system has landed up precisely in the minus state, which you could never have done if it had started from simply a description in which it was definitely in one state or the other with equal probability. You can easily demonstrate that. So again, that's a case where merely inspecting the reduced density matrix of the system itself is highly misleading. It does not give you all the information you need. However, I don't think that's the worst about the it's not the worst objection to the orthodox argument. The worst objection to the orthodox argument is step 3. In effect, so this step is not usually stated explicitly in the hundreds of papers which have come out along these lines. What you're in effect saying is that since all the predictions for all experimentally measurable quantities are the same as if the system were, they would be, if S were in a definite state I, with probability Ci squared, therefore S indeed is in a definite state I with probability Ci squared. And that seems to me a gross logical lacuna. It essentially confuses the meaning of the quantum formalism with the evidence that a particular meaning is or is not correct. I should go back for a moment. At the microscopic level, unless you're prepared to make the kind of extreme contortions that the Bohmians make, you can't interpret the meaning of a quantum superposition as saying that each system of the ensemble definitely was in one state or the other, that each given electron, say, in a Young slit experiment went through one slit or the other. Why do you believe you can't do that? Well, the evidence against that is the phenomenon of interference, which we all know and love at the level of single particles. Now let's go up to the macroscopic level, let's say the level of billiard balls. Suppose that you were to try to do a Young slit experiment with billiard balls. Well, there are all sorts of reasons why it wouldn't work, but let's focus on the fact that a billiard ball is certainly interacting rather strongly with the environment, in particular with the black body radiation field. And therefore, if you were to actually try to do that experiment, and as we'll see actually later in the next lecture, experiments along these sort of general lines have been done, in fact, what you'll find is that you don't get any interesting interference pattern at all. The pattern which emerges is exactly as if each individual billiard ball had gone through one slit or the other. So the evidence against that interpretation of the quantum formalism has gone away. The formalism itself, however, has not changed one bit on going from the microscopic to the macroscopic level. So then one has to ask the question, just because the evidence has disappeared, does that mean that we're entitled to fundamentally reinterpret the meaning of the formalism? And I claim that would be a gross logical non sequitur. It's a bit like arguing that you have a murder trial where there's a certain piece of evidence which everyone says is sure to convict the accused. So they all say he's certainly guilty. Suppose halfway through the murder trial that vital piece of evidence mysteriously disappears. Does that mean the accused has suddenly become innocent? I don't think so. So similarly, I don't think you can use the fact that the evidence has gone away to reinterpret the meaning of the formalism. That was basically what I intended to be the content of the first half of this talk. Let me stop at this point and ask if there are any comments or discussion on it. So what I'm basically the conclusion I'm drawing here, in some sense, at least informally, is that really there is no... if we assume that the formalism of quantum mechanics is going to describe the physical world up to and possibly even including the level of our own consciousness, then I personally don't believe that there is any interpretation which is entirely satisfactory. I mean, if some time traveler were to come back from the year 3000 and tell me that in the year 3000 people are still believing that quantum mechanics is the whole truth about the physical universe and ask me to react, I think what I'd have to do is to fall back on what I call the quantum information theoretic interpretation. It is nothing but a recipe, etc. But pretty uncomfortable about that. Okay, so any questions or comments? Well, if not, I could try to go on to at least the beginnings of what I intended to be the second half of the lecture. I think we probably, given what was happening in terms of time, we may not be able to finish this, but I could at least start trying. Okay, so let's go back to question one. Is quantum mechanics the whole truth? That is, will it correctly continue to predict the results of experiments up to and including the level of our own, possibly including the level of our own direct consciousness. Okay, let's try experimenting with the answer no. So if we answer no, then what we are in some sense requiring or conjecturing is an alternative theory which at some point in the future will become supervenient on quantum mechanics, which has the following, at least the following properties. First of all, it really has to agree pretty well with quantum mechanics at the atomic and subatomic levels. Why? Well, simply because, you know, we now know from 100 years of experience that quantum mechanics really does get things pretty right at those levels. Obviously, there would be a scope for some small and perhaps currently unmeasurable deviation from predictions of quantum mechanics there. But to a zeroth approximation, it certainly has to agree with the predictions of quantum mechanics. Secondly, it has to... the whole point of the operation is that at some level, between the level of our direct consciousness and the level of the atom, it's got to affect the realization of a single definite outcome. In other words, we would like Schrödinger's cat, each individual Schrödinger's cat, to definitely be dead or definitely be alive before we actually take the lid off the box and look at her. Thirdly, under the conditions of a sort of standard measurement situation or something similar, it's got to give agreement with the standard quantum measurement axiom. In other words, if when I apply standard quantum mechanics, the system, and I'm measuring some variable, some operator whose eigenfunctions are phi sub I, say, if I start off in quantum mechanics with a superposition of such states with coefficient C sub I, then we all know that the probability, according to standard quantum mechanics, the probability of getting the result I is modulo C sub I squared. And that's, we assume that, at least to date, that has actually been confirmed experimentally. So any kind of alternative theory has got to agree with that result. When I start off at the micro level with this kind of superposition, then no matter what machinations or manipulations I do to it, going up from the micro to the macro level, the outcome, the macroscopic outcome of my experiment has still got to agree with the quantum predictions. It's possible, I think, define a general theory of this class as macro-realistic, and later I'll come back and try to make a more precise definition of what I mean by a macro-realistic theory. But I think you get the general point. In the literature, there are a number of examples of such theories. The best, by far the best developed one is the so-called GRWP, that's Girardi-Rimini-Weber-Pearl theory, which I will talk about in considerably more detail. But there are more qualitative theories or approaches due to Penrose, to Adler, to DOC, and various other people in the history of the subject. I think one can divide macro-realistic theories into two general categories. The first category is one in which, in principle at least, there are already corrections to the quantum mechanical predictions at the level of electrons and atoms, but they are so tiny that right now we can't actually detect them. However, for one reason or another, they may get amplified on the way up so that by the time they get to the level of Schrödinger's cat, we very definitely can detect them and make a big difference. And certainly the GRWP theory has that nature. Penrose's theory does to at least to an extent, and I think, although I sometimes since I last looked at it, Adler's theory has that general character. It's possible, however, to think of a different class of macro-realistic theories, in which there are basically no corrections to quantum mechanics at all at the level of single atoms or electrons. But by the time you get up to a certain level of size or complexity or some other relevant figure of merit, something goes wrong and you have to apply a very different kind of theory. Now, these criticism, which is sometimes levelled at this what I call this type 2 macro-realistic theory, it can't be. It turns out it can't be levelled at type 1 theories, but it is levelled at this type 2 theory. It says, look, why on earth should the number of let's just make a very crudest version of a. I mean, it's so crude as to be ridiculous, but let's just make it for the sake of an Aunt Sally to shoot at, of type 2 theory. Let's suppose that as long as you have a superposition, some kind of superposition, which involves the entanglement of less than 10 to the 6th particles, then quantum mechanics works absolutely fine. The moment the entanglement involves more than 10 to the 6 particles, then something goes drastically wrong and you have to start applying some unknown future theory, which is completely different from quantum mechanics and alternative to it. I say that's so crude that it sounds ridiculous, but let's just see the kind of objection that would most obviously be made to it. Well, the kind of objection which is made is, look, why on earth should the number of particles be a relevant variable here? We all know that the behaviour of say molecules is governed by the same principles as governs the law of atoms. The laws which govern the behaviour of atoms are essentially the same in principle as those which govern the behaviour of the individual components, and so on and so forth. So, you know, why should the mere fact that you've increased the number of particles involved have any relevance whatever? Well, I mean, I think in this particular, in the particular example I gave, that would certainly be a rather plausible kind of objection. But in a more general sense, I think one has to be a little more careful and sceptical. You see, basically, what we're relying on is the fact that in quantum mechanics. Let's put it slightly differently. Suppose I were to argue that, say, I went back to before 1999, when there were no experiments on diffraction of fluorines and so forth, and I were to argue that, we've seen diffraction of single electrons, and as a matter of fact, we've also seen small molecules, but let's put that aside for the moment. We've seen that when we're talking about single particles, single electrons, single neutrons, whatever, we get these standard Young-Slits interference effects. Let me imagine that I said in 1995, I believe that when we're talking about complex objects, like, say, in the future fullerenes, since we're now talking about the behavior of the center of mass rather than the behavior of a single particle, I believe that's going to behave quite differently. And people will say, well, you're nuts. It's obvious that there's no distinction in principle between describing a system in terms of the individual particle coordinates and describing it in terms of center of mass and relative variables. So that idea is completely nutty. Is it nutty? If you imagine, let's do a thought experiment. Imagine that we go back to the year... Oh, I don't know, let's say 1874, okay, for sake of argument. And I go back armed with my, travel back in time, armed with my knowledge of 21st century physics. And I say to the guys back in 1874, look, I'm afraid you guys are really on the wrong track because you've been doing this standard mechanics, as we would say now, classical mechanics, they would just call it mechanics. You've been doing this mechanics, but what you're going to find is that when the motion you're considering involves products of the sort of characteristic energies and characteristic times, which become as small as 10 to the minus 34 joule seconds, thanks, Hansen, then everything is going to change qualitatively. You're going to have to start cooking up a completely new theory. Okay. Now, what would their reaction be? Their reaction would be to pat me on the shoulder and say, well, sorry, old boy, I mean, it's an interesting idea, but you know, it really won't fly. Because we all know that mechanics does not tolerate any scale. The concept of a scale is just not there in mechanics. Well, what would you say now? Of course, yeah, of course, within what we now call classical mechanics, there's no concept of a characteristic scale. In quantum mechanics, however, there is. In other words, something which looked as if it was a sort of totally irrelevant variable in the context of the old theory looks like very, very relevant indeed in the context of the new one. So I think it's not a priori absurd. I mean, you may think it's, for all sorts of other reasons, implausible, but it's not a priori absurd to contemplate the idea that complexity or number of particles at the very crudest level, or some kind of complexity or organization, might itself be a relevant variable. And that in some future theory which supervenes over quantum mechanics, you might actually find that this degree of complexity, degree of entanglement, whatever, plays a fundamental role. This is not something we should exclude a priori. Okay, so since I only have 10 minutes left, I'm certainly not going to get through the whole of GRWP discussion, but let me just start on it. GRWP is certainly the best developed macro-realistic theory which we have at present. History is that Pearl in the US and Ghirardi and co-workers in Italy had for quite some years been thinking about how to construct what I would call a macro-realistic theory. That is a theory which would basically agree with quantum mechanics at the micro level, but then guarantee you specific outcomes at the macro level. In 1984, GRW published their first paper on this, Ghirardi-Rimini Weber. They unfortunately wrote it in such a way that a lot of people initially thought it was just another of these hundreds of decoherence papers, that they were basically just invoking the standard decoherence argument. And it took a certain amount of effort to make people see that was not so, that this actually was a new theory which was alternative to quantum mechanics. Anyway, Pearl had been thinking along rather similar lines, and in 1989 the two groups basically got together and produced what nowadays is usually called the either GRWP by their initials, Ghirardi-Rimini-Weber-Pearl, or alternatively CSL for continuous spontaneous localization. Now, if you want to, if you don't know about this theory and want to find out about it, I would strongly recommend the original paper of Pearl in 1989. It's a very, very clear paper. I actually think it's a classic paper, although it's not, you know, in terms of citations and so forth, it probably hasn't made that huge an impact. There's a recent and very comprehensive review by Bessie and Ghirardi in Physics Reports a few years ago, which goes into a lot of details. But I really think that the Pearl paper is the one to actually learn this stuff from if you want to. Let me... 89, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm sorry, it's not very clear, like many things in these graphs. Okay, let me at least try to sketch the general idea in these last few minutes, and then perhaps we can go on to the details in the next lecture. It really is, I think, a very ingenious theory. In fact, I would actually say that the amount of intellectual effort which went into formulating this theory may well be comparable to what went into formulating quantum mechanics itself in the original version. The general idea is that there is a universal noise background which is not itself subject to the principles of quantum mechanics, and that's absolutely crucial. So, the moment you let this noise itself be quantum mechanical and be described by the same kind of scheme, that you've lost everything, basically, from this. So it better not be quantum mechanical. The effect of this noise is to inject a non-unitary term into the time-dependent Schrödinger equation, such that for any particular realization of the noise, the wave function tends to be enhanced in those spatial regions which, as it were, the noise hits, and it's reduced elsewhere. The norm of the total wave, since the term is not unitary, the norm of the wave function is not conserved. Normally, generally speaking, it'll tend to decrease, but occasionally it'll tend to increase. Now, So far, you haven't got any nonlinear element. However, the nonlinear element is that, having got this, these results, you now define your physical ensemble by weighting the different realizations of the noise with the norm of the wave function which each produces. That's a very non-quantum mechanical kind of operation. And that then does have an appropriate nonlinear effect. So, crudely speaking, the effect is to take a physical ensemble, which corresponds to two widely separated wave packets, and to transform it continuously and objectively, but stochastically, into one of its branches. So, crudely speaking, the evolution of the the physical probability, suppose I start off with a single particle, say, it has a probability density which is concentrated in two wave packets. Yeah? I'll talk about this quantity alpha in a moment, but it's concentrated in these two wave packets which are fairly widely separated, as for example in the Young-Slitz experiment. So the effect of the noise and the subsequent effect on the Schrödinger equation is that the physical probability of being in one or other of those wave packets will gradually shrink and increase in the other. Now, this may not be a monotonic process. You may find that there are oscillations or whatever in this process, but at the end of the day, you'll certainly end up in one of the two wave packets. Moreover, you will end up with a probability which is proportional to the norm of the original two wave packets. In other words, you'll get exactly the quantum mechanical predictions. Now, how can this happen? Well, let me skip ahead of myself for a moment and say one way of thinking about this is that when you look examine in detail the physical processes involved in manipulating your Schrödinger equation in this way, it's a sort of continuous example of what is in probability theory called a gambler's ruin process. Does everyone know what the gambler's ruin process is? No? Okay. So imagine that you have two players who are going to toss a fair coin. And they each start with a certain amount of money, a certain number of dollars. And every time the coin comes down heads, say, then gambler one is going to give gambler two a dollar. If it comes down tails, then it'll be the other way around. Okay? So they exchange a dollar one way or the other, according to each toss of the coin. Now, there are two rather nice simple theorems one can prove. And this has nothing to do with quantum mechanics. This is all to do with classical probability theory. Theorem number one, after a sufficiently long time, one player will end up with all the money. That's no matter what distribution they started. Right? Theorem number two, if gambler one starts with a fraction p of the money and gambler two with 1 minus p, then the probability of gambler one ending up with all the money is simply p. Okay? In other words, rather crudely and satisfyingly, the probability of coming out the winner is simply proportional to the share of the money you put in the first place. Okay? There's a rather simple way of seeing that. The expectation value of the money which a particular player has cannot change with the losses, because if the coin is fair, if the coin comes down heads, he will gain a dollar. If it comes down tails, he will lose a dollar. So the expectation value can't change. Now, at the beginning of the game, the expectation value was p. At the end of the game, either he has it or he doesn't. He has it with probability p, he doesn't have it with probability 1 minus p, so that expectation value must be the same. So as I say, it's a very trivial theorem of classical probability theory. But that's crudely how that works, and I'll come back to that in a bit more detail later. Let me just conclude with just remarking a few important points. The hitting process is characterized, and we'll see how exactly this comes out next time, but it's characterized by a characteristic length alpha, which for historical reasons is usually called not R0 as it ought to be, but alpha to the minus a half. And the result of the interaction with the noise is such that within a distance is short compared to that characteristic length. The structure of the wave function is just preserved, just as it would be in quantum mechanics. However, for distances much larger than that, it can be strongly modified. Secondly, there's a characteristic timescale, lambda, for the reduction process for a single particle. And then, what is really nice, I think, about the GRWP theory, and maybe it's not something that's very easy to see ahead of time, is that quite automatically, it turns out that for a large body containing n particles, then that time is drastically shortened. It may be shortened, depending on the exact assumptions you make, it may be shortened by a factor n to the minus 1 or perhaps even n to the minus 2 in some cases. And finally, as I already said, the probability of finding the system at the end of the day in a particular region of space is exactly what the quantum mechanical prediction would give. Okay. So as I said, I think it's a very, very ingenious theory. I will try to spend the first few minutes of the next lecture going into some of the details on that, which are in themselves, I think, not at all trivial and quite rather interesting. Before I stop today, any questions or comments?
Yes. So this oscillation is irreversible.
Think of the gambler's ruin situation. Even if, let us say, initially, player A starts with, say, 80% of the money and player B with 20%. Okay, they exchange, they do their tosses. And let us suppose that as a result of this particular series of tosses, player B's money starts to shrink. So he's only got $5 left. But now the next few tosses just happen to turn out in his favor. So he comes back up again. He may even get past 50%, as it were. All one can actually talk about is the probability that at sufficiently long times, A will have acquired all the money and be left with nothing, or vice versa. And as I say, there is a theorem that, given sufficiently long time, this is always going to happen. What one can strictly speaking say, I guess, is that there is a probability that after n tosses, one player or the other will have ended up with all the money. That probability tends to 1 with n. Now, I don't remember exactly how it tends with n, but we could try to work that out. It's a very simple theorem in classical probability theory.
But what is the time scale here?
Oh, yes, good question. For a single particle, the time scale would be essentially lambda to the minus 1. Now, as we'll see, when we come to ask what are plausible numbers to put in here, this lambda is not something which is fixed a priori by the theory. What you have to do is to fit it in such a way that it makes sense with respect to the actual experimental data. And what we'll in fact find is that the sort of canonical value of lambda which people put in is something like 10 to the minus 16 per second. So in other words, a single particle is reduced on that kind of length scale. That would take 10 to the 16 seconds. Okay. So that has the advantage that we can take a photon, say, which is coming from the most distant quasar visible in the universe, and that photon has been on the road for probably something somewhat less than 10 to the 16 seconds. I forget the exact number. But anyway, you put that photon through the arms of a Michelson interferometer, say, at a length of 100 meters, still get exactly what quantum mechanics says. On the other hand, you see, you have this factor of n to the minus 1. So that means if you take that 10 to the minus 16 seconds and take a Schrödinger's cat situation, well, what's n for Schrödinger's cat? Something like 10 to the 30th, probably. Because then now the reduction time is only 10 to the minus 14 seconds. So it does have that highly desired property. Nothing goes wrong with quantum mechanics at the level of single electrons or atoms, or even at least certain mesoscopic systems. By the time you get up to our own level of everyday consciousness, things change drastically. So I actually think this is this really was a substantial milestone in foundational studies when this theory was evolved. I certainly feel somewhat anxious to propagate it, or at least make it better known.
It seems that there's a reason to pay for experimental proposal testing.
Is this the one you're thinking of, the one from the Vienna group, Marcus Aschbaumeier? Yes, that's a very exciting prospect. If they if that experiment can be done as they hope it can, then in some sense, a lot of what I'm going to be talking about in the next lecture is going to be obsolete, because the systems which have been used so far can't really compare to this one if it can be achieved. I think it's not a trivial if, but
Or is it trying to directly test something? It's trying to directly test something.
Well, they're actually trying to take something much more general. They want to do the kind of test for a general class of macro-realistic theories, which Anupam Guga and I proposed back in 1985. They also want to test specifically this GRWP type of theory. I mean, if this system really works, then it's really almost ideal, I'd say, for all this whole general class of tests.